Right. Oh, hello everyone. I'm the guy that kicked out the cable in the last presentation. So I'm gonna do a presentation about like called Destroying the Shoe. It was a production that I worked on at Colorbleed Animation Studios, and I did most of the like the effects and the procedural model stuff. So I'm only gonna talk about the effects and the procedural model stuff, not about the rendering stuff, but I'm going to talk about the exchange with Maya and V-Ray because that's what they use for shading there. So first, a little bit about myself. This is my name, and I'm sort of a generalist, but I'm mostly doing effects nowadays. And I like designed this thing like a couple of years ago. Anyway, this is me. I freelance and I work at a ton of different studios. I mostly work on location, sometimes do stuff from home. And I also record like frequent like online tutorials and stuff, and like do personal work. And these are some things like personal projects that I did, which you might recognize if you follow me on the internet. That's me basically. But yeah, now I'm gonna talk about the Destroying the Shoe, which is basically it's a last year. I did at Colorbleed, we did a thing called the Spin Awards, which I talked about last year. And it was like a motion graphics-y type opening for the Spin Awards. It was an award ceremony thing. And then later, the guys from the Solid Gear, the shoe, which you're about to see, they come to Colorbleed and like, yeah, we like that video, make exactly that, but then for our shoe. That was kind of the briefing, so it's kind of the same similar concept, but then like for actual shoe. So I'm gonna show the video first, and then I'm gonna do a breakdown of like each of the effects and like the challenges and all of that stuff. I don't think the audio works that great here, so you have to imagine all of the sound that goes with it. It comes from the speakers here, but it's not gonna go on the things. So hopefully this is gonna work. So there's like. Just imagine all the effects. So it's all one single camera move thing basically, and like a lot of procedural models like the fibers and then effects, the droplets and stuff. And the sound design was really awesome as well, but that we don't have that here, so. So that's the CG shoe, and as you can see, it looks really cool and stuff. And then this is the actual shoe. So yeah, it's like the like CG is better. Like in my opinion, the CG one looks much cooler than the real one. And also, this was like the prototype shoe, and they actually changed the shoe like 10 times, like the actual shoe 10 times or something during the couple of weeks that we worked on this, because I did all the effects in 3 weeks and they changed the shoe like, I don't know, like 5, 6, 7 times. I don't know. It was like, yeah, and then this, like the thing on the front, the color that changed and the bottom changed. And so I didn't do any of the modeling they did. They did like photogrammetry, and then they re-topologized thing, and they made the whole mesh from that, the modeler guys, and they did a great job, especially because you're super close on the whole thing, like you needed all the details. So I'm glad that I didn't have to do any of that, because it's like a ton of work. Let me just destroy the whole thing, which is the theme of the presentation as well. You can also say like create the shoe, I guess, because it's also building the thing. Okay, some challenges. So I was there for 3 weeks to do all of the effects shots and the like the procedural things like the fibers and stuff. It's one single shot, but there's 6 different effect type of shots which integrate into the whole thing. And as I said, the whole shoe itself was undergoing changes throughout the entire film until like the last week or something. So that was really useful to do all this stuff in Houdini, because I could just swap out the alembic and then everything would still work. So it wasn't that bad, but like there was still stuff that you had to redo a lot of times. So let's go through each of, I'm gonna go through each of the effects one by one and talk about how I did the stuff. And actually a lot of the effects were, like the setups are pretty easy, to be honest, because I didn't have time to build any super complex type of setups, because there was obviously not a lot of time. So all of the setups are pretty easy in terms of how they were constructed, but they worked pretty well and they were easy to iterate on. So the first thing, like the cage thing, so you have both two elements. There's the metal bars and then the cloth stuff growing. So basically the cage thing was really really simple. So you have basically the shoe model that they made. And then I have my Mayday, just a spline cage. Actually didn't do that in Houdini. I made a spline cage in Cinema 4D, because Cinema 4D it's just really easy to double click and then etch the spline and could just keep clicking, and it was just faster to make the whole cage model in Cinema 4D than it was to do that in in Houdini, because it was but then I brought the whole thing in Houdini and I made a growing type of effect, which is basically just carve. You have to carve sop and just carve along the curve, and then you have a, you can use a primitive sop, which basically lets you offset the begin point of a curve. So if you want to let it basically carve and you want to start at a different position, you can use the primitive sop and you can offset the starting point, so it'll grow from a different point. And then I'm gonna go to this slide, which says video 0101. That's because like LibreOffice doesn't want you to, you can embed video, but it can, you cannot play and pause it. So no idea what's up with that. So I'm gonna go to my folder, and I'm gonna go into the thing and open the video. So basically, you see, there's a lot of stuff jumping in, but that was completely fine because you didn't see that in the video anyway. So I just basically went through the whole thing and just animated. Like I had the animated camera and I just went through it and just moved some sliders until something looked cool. And then you go through the, you put all of the carved splines, you put them in a for each loop. What a for each loop does is iterates on every of the splines. And then you basically you take the spline and then you take, okay, we have the current point number and we have the total number of points, and you divide that, so the current point number by the total number of points, then you get a 0 to 1 value, and you can ramp that to get like the thicker to thinner type of effect. And then you can use that to generate with a polywire, basically a very basic sub, to just generate some thickness and then crank that to Maya and render it. It's pretty easy stuff. Then the, let me go to the, back to the PowerPoint thing again. Where is the, right, the second one, I'm just gonna leave it like this. So the second one with the cloth, that was kind of more interesting. Basically you have the shoe again. I just strip away all of the stuff that's basically redundant, and I needed a lower res model for that thing. So I took a bounding box and I rayed all of the sides of the box towards the center of the cage that I made, and then you're left with a simple representation of the shoe. And then I subdivided the shit out of it because I needed tons of points, and I'll go into why later. I think on the next one is another video slide. Let me go to, yeah, there we go. Okay, so this is gonna go over the, okay, I'm just gonna talk over this. So yeah, there we have this shoe thing, and yeah, so we're making this low res cage model, which is basically us taking the box and splicing it towards the side of the shoes. Then generating some very basic UVs, just a basic simple projection thing. Didn't need to be any complex because you're flying through the thing anyway, so it didn't need to be super complex UVs or anything. And then I'm just putting some random spheres there, which I'm using just to set the positions of where I'm gonna grow an attribute. Like I'm making a custom attribute, which is the red, which is gonna grow over the sides of the of the shoe. And basically what it does, let me pause the thing, is guess if you ever opened Houdini, you used the attribute transfer before. Basically what an attribute transfer does is like you have a second input and it's gonna look at every current point in the shoe. So that's why I subdivided like the shit out of it. I don't need a lot of points. It's gonna look at every point and it's gonna look at the second input around the surrounding points, and it's gonna transfer the value that it finds, which is close to the second input, and it's gonna apply it to the main input based on the radius which you define. But in an attribute transfer, you can only have a regular, like you can grow it and you can fall off it, but you cannot do more interesting stuff with it. But if you do it in a VOP, you can add some noise to it. Like, as you can see over there, you can just add some noise. So you basically do the same. You do a point cloud and you're adding some noise to the transfer basically, and then you get this, yeah, this kind of a fancy noisy type of effect. Then you just blast away everything that's not, yeah, that doesn't have the attribute. So then you're left with like this cage thing. Then I'm transferring the attribute again from the spheres that I had, now with a regular attribute transfer, and then I can do this like this fall off type thing. So then you have a fall off on your attribute, and then I can just do a attribute forward and just taking the position. I'm taking some noise and I'm just like displacing it and adding some fancy noisy type of effect, which looks cooler from the outside. Like when you're inside, you don't really see it a lot, but like you don't notice it that much because it's kind of dark. But it did add a bit to the overall effect. So okay, let's go further. Hurry up. Oh yeah, and then I'm extruding the thing a little bit because I needed some thickness. Obviously, if it's gonna be flat, it's like cloth isn't gonna be completely flat, especially like later we're flying inside the cloth, so you can see it's there's some thickness. Oh yeah, and this is when you're exporting it to Maya. Maya needs to have a way to like determine which are the inside edges. So what you can do is, if you like in Houdini, you have a differentiation between points and vertices. In Maya, you don't really have that. You just basically work on vertices. But what you can do is you can use vertex colors. So what I did is I just made everything black, and I made the insides that are extruded. They get a separate group, and I'm just adding the red color to the extruded group, which is the inside. And what Tom, the guy that shaded everything, did is he could like take that inside color and he could use V-Ray fur inside of Maya to like scatter some hairs, so when it grows, you still have some sort of a fiber kite structure, which is basically just V-Ray hairs being generated. It's not super visible in the final thing, but that's how you can use like in Maya to mask out certain features of certain objects. Just use different colors, vertex colors, and you can use that to mask the stuff that you're doing. Alright, let's go back to the thingy. Yeah, the Gore-Tex fibers. Yeah, so Gore-Tex is like the company that makes the fiber structure, which is like, it's a fiber structure that's resistant to water and stuff, and it's like supposed to be super strong. So let's go to the next thing. So these are actual close-ups of the thing, and I thought they kind of look like spider egg sacs things, and like especially this, it just looks kind of disgusting. But like I kind of more like that kind of vibe, so we try to sort of go into the middle to like get that sort of structure, but still have sort of the spider egg sac kind of look, because that's what it actually looks like in my opinion. And I think we're up for another video. Oh no, not yet. So this is the structure that I generated. Like without shaders, it doesn't really look that interesting, but you have you have the basic structure basically, and then those X-axis and wires coming off of it. And these, the black ones and the red stuff, is actual geometry. The white lines are splines basically, and you can use V-Ray, Maya, you can use hair, for example, to render that. To mesh everything would be too, it was too heavy to mesh everything. And as you can see, there's a little bit of a fall off coming from the X-axis. so he can offset the displacement, because he was using the, like, you wanted those little bulgy things on the sacks basically, and you wanted to have a fall off so it wouldn't be instant bumpiness, and then no bumpiness. So let's go to the next thing. I think now we're ready for a video. Yeah, we are. Let's go. Do do do. All right. Okay, let's go to the beginning. Okay. Okay, so I'm starting off just with a box, and I'm adding some noises to deform it, and then I'm forwarding or fracturing it. So just fracturing it, like basically if you do a rigid body stem, you do the same, but then you get those inside lines. So if you do a comfort line, you get inside lines of the thing. And then adding a whole bunch of extra noises and stuff. And then you're fusing, if you're fusing lines together, so let me, Jesus Christ, okay. So if you're, you have the structure and you fuse, you use a fuse together, and you just make all of the lines like combine into one thing. And then if you smooth it, then it sort of smooths into a kind of a web-like structure, which is this. Let's go further into it. So you already have this sort of web-like structure, and I'm just scattering some extra points on there. So just same points, and I'm making a random ID based on every point. And now what? I have no idea why it's going back constantly. So I'm making a random ID for every point, and then based on the ID number, if you round it off, you can add lines again based on the ID. So I'm gonna do that here, I think. So you get some extra lines. So it's not basically the foreign noise stuff. You just get some extra lines, and you just put them in again, and you merge them, and you smooth it again, and yeah, then you get that thing, and then more noises. Just, you can see it's pretty messy, everything, but like, not a lot of time, so it was just plumping away stuff and tried to make it look cool. Oh yeah, so here are the, like the X-axis, basically. So when I, let me pause it. So basically, but it's just a very simple script. Like, you only want them to have to appear in like at places where a lot of the lines come together. So basically, what you can do is you can just make a there's a function called neighbor count. So you can just say if neighbor count is greater than, and then I made a slider just the max neighbor, and if it's greater than how many neighbors each point has. So if it has, like, for example, 6 points, then it will throw them in a group, and then you can copy to that group. You can copy all of the spheres, and then that way you can have the x-axis only appear at certain intersections instead of having them all over the place. Right, let's continue the thing, and then some noise. Obviously, just add noise on everything. Noise makes everything look good. All right, then we boolean everything together, and a new boolean never breaks. It's awesome. You can just like throw everything in there, so now it just becomes one mesh, and then yeah, and then I think I'm doing some attribute transfer later. I think I forgot to record that. Just some extra lines being generated there, and then go to the other thing. Yeah, this is basically, pause it. Is just basically extra lines that you had that were too heavy to include in the geometry. So what this basically just is you have each of those like x-axis, and you just scatter points at the surrounding, like the surrounding web that you have. And if you copy lines to those points, so you just get a simple line just with 2 points. And if you group before you copy, like one of the points, so you can group only one of the, like the zeroed point, for example, and you copy it, then all of the endpoints will end up in the same group after you copy them. So what you can then do is just ray the thing that Simon was also talking about. You can just ray them towards the x-axis again, and then you get those get those lines going from the outside stuff back to the x-axis basically. I think that's the that's the end of this video. And then obviously you need to make nice shaders to make this look any decent. And then then you end up with that basically. Alright, next thing. Alright, the droplets. So there was the droplets were actually kind of easy. I was like, okay, this is gonna be horrible. It was actually one of the easier parts. It's basically it's just very low res FEM simulation. So FEM is like soft body objects. So there wasn't any flip simulation or anything. It's just super low res sphere things. And what I did is I just made these things. I took the collision object from the shoe and I just moved the gravity sideways and downwards, and they would just fall to the side and then roll down. So that's that. And then they move a little bit, and I think another video. And then you just transform the original geometry, like the higher res blobs, with that thing. So let's first watch a little animatic thing of how that looks. So that thing without it being rendered. And then let's go into the second video where we're showing this, and there's weird stuff going on over there, but you don't notice it anyway. So that's the main stuff, just falling to the side and rolling down. So that's one part of it. And then there's a second part, which is just some sop animations, which I'm gonna show now, I think. So you just scatter some points on the side of the shoe. And then you do a, let me pause it. Then you just do a very simple script thing. You look, doing the p dot y, so the y position. You're making a random, like a random for each point, and then you're offsetting for each point based on a random value downwards. So they just randomly move downwards. So it's kind of like droplets moving randomly downwards. So then they move randomly downwards. Then you ray them again to the and like as I heard from Simon yesterday, apparently the fax frame function is much faster, so probably gonna use that next time. But it wasn't that bad. It's still fast over here. Then you're adding some random skills, and you're just copying spheres to it again. So just some wobbly sphere things, and then you're adding more noise, because noise makes everything looks good, basically. Just add noise on everything. So I think I'm doing the, just add noise in the attribute swap thing. So yeah, and then you're getting this kind of wobbly water-like look. And then you merged all stuff together, and then you have the static stuff, which was on the side in the beginning, and the actual simulation stuff. And then you have something that looks very complicated, but was really simple to make. So okay, let's go to the next thing. All right. So the fibers. So actually, going into video. So those like the fiber stuff over here is actual geometry. So you're gonna fly through it. So I had to make the actual geometry so you could fly through it. And then later we blend to a displacement texture. But like initially when we made the video, we didn't know exactly how fast the camera was gonna move. So in the end, it might have also worked with just a displacement map, because the camera is going quite fast. But I made the actual geometry for the fibers to fly through. So let's show that thing. Oh yeah, and this is a little trick that that I found out. So let me, So natively, there's no way to display thickness of hairs and shading in the Houdini viewport. Correct me if I'm wrong, but I found out if you just make a hair generation object and you merge just any random splines in it, you can get a visualization of it, as long as it's the width attribute. So if you put a hair object in it, like a hair shader on it, and you merge random splines in it, and you get a nice visualization with shading in your viewport. I hope Side Effects makes something that just has native spline display in the viewport. unless I'm missing something and it's already there. But I this was the only way that I found to do it, and this just makes it easier to look at instead of just having a just white splines, which is what you're gonna see over here. I think those are just black, just white splines. Like, you cannot really see what's going on. Well, if you just throw them in the hair object, you can actually see what's going on, so that makes it much more usable for visualization type of stuff. If you actually want to see what you're doing without rendering the whole thing. All right, so let's go into how this thing was made. So just get a circle thing, and then like scatter some points on it, and just copy some lines. Just get a bunch of lines. And then we're twirling them around, and you're like, why would you do that? It looks weird, but we'll get to that in a second. Then on the other side, we're making half of the pattern that we're needing for the weave, because the weave needed to match up with, obviously, the displacement texture that we had. And if you take that weave, if you offset it, like you use two of them, then you get the actual weave, which matches up with the displacement texture that we had. Okay, so I'm gonna continue the player. Okay, so then what we're doing, okay, then what I'm doing is I have a line, just a straight line up with the same point count as the pattern that I made. And then we're going in a VOP, so in a second, hurry up, go into the thing. Yeah, right, yeah, almost, okay, there we go. So basically, like, you can also do this with a point cloud if the point count matches up. So you can do it like this. If you don't have matching point clouds, you need to do a point cloud, like what I was explaining earlier with looking at surrounding points. But since the point cloud matches up, you can just take the position of one point and then import the position of the second input, which is the pattern that I made, subtract the positions. So then you get a vector pointing in a certain way. So you get, like, if you have a line and you make another line which is like this, and you subtract the positions, then you get a vector pointing in that direction, basically. And you can invert that vector, and then you get a vector pointing in the same direction, and I'm outputting that to the normal. So you get normals in that direction. So gonna continue on the thing. So yeah, now I'm getting these weird normals that look absolutely useless, but they're actually super useful. So then what I'm doing is I'm just go down in the thing, just transferring them to the weird circular thing that I made, so you have even weirder looking normals. And then I'm using a displace along normal, so I just have this just the original position, and I'm displacing them towards the normals, so then you get the weaving pattern of the that I made before. And it's still, like, it doesn't work perfectly, so the tops are a little bit flat, but you can sort of relax that, and it worked fine for this occasion. And you can use the slider to do that. So basically what a displace along normal is just basically takes the position vector, just takes a normal vector, and it just adds those together, and then you get a new position. So it's kind of easy. I just smooth and do random stuff, and then like make them interweave, and then you have that thing. And then that's the total weave. As I see, like, it's very hard to see what's going on here. That's why the hair visualization thing is just much more useful if you're working, to just check if everything looks the way you want it to look. And then we're making a whole patch of that thing. So, and that's the patch which you're flying through, basically. And that's a ton of points in total. Yeah, and then those are the holes on the shoe, which there was, you were flying through, you were flying through the shoe, and there's like these little patches inside of the shoe, which are like really tiny, but they're orange in the middle, and they're like sort of have an inset. So needed to be a way to do that. So you just, I made some random things there and just made an attribute, transferred the attribute, and then you can use that attribute to just displace them along the displace that along that attribute again with a little ramp for the inset thing. And the same attribute that I put on there, you can export that to Maya as like as an attribute, and then you can do whatever you want with it in Maya. So that's how that the fiber stuff was made. So, and as you can see, the visualization really helps, because now you can actually see the structure instead of looking at a flat thing. So yeah, and then that goes straight into Maya for rendering purposes. Right, let's go do the next one. Oh, the rubber and the cloth stuff, which a lot of people apparently thought really was really cool, and it was really easy to make, to be honest. So another video. So many videos. Right, let's go do the thing. So I only have a video for the rubber thing. I forgot to record a video for the fiber thing. I have some screenshots for that, but you'll see in a bit. So this rubber thing is actually just super simple. You just have a sphere with some noise, which is just growing, and just like doing a just doing a boolean and just cutting the whole crap apart. So then you get this thing, and then I'm transferring another attribute from the main sphere again, so you get an attribute with a fall off that's gonna appear over there, with a little bit of a ramp, and then you can use that ramped attribute to get sort of a bulging type of effect. So you get more of a, when it melts, it gets sort of a like a bulging kind of effect that makes it kind of look cooler, and then just throw it to VDBs, and that's gonna smooth it, and then throw it in a VDB. VDB is a volumetric kind of thing, and if you mesh that, it just gets, now it gets more of the like a weird bubbly looking thing, which was cool. And then I'm transferring the UV attribute, and you get really weird stuff over there, but like they fixed that in GOMP, so it was fine. So that wasn't my problem. I just took too much time to figure out how to get that work. But like always, when you're transferring UV stuff, there's always like a ton of crap. And it's in this case, because there wasn't a lot of time, it wasn't worth it to make a solution that would do it perfectly. And the UVs did have to match with the original geometry, because there was the UV that was on there. It needed to be the same, because like for comp stuff, so it couldn't change, else it would look weird. All right, let's go to the next thingy. How much time do I have left? Probably enough. Oh, plenty of time. Go to the next thingy. Oh yeah, and this was like Morris is probably like, okay, I know what this is. for the cloth stuff, this is basically, and Tagma has a tutorial on how to do this, so it doesn't really matter that I don't have a video for it anyway. I'm still gonna explain it and just look at his tutorial to see how it works. Basically, what you do is you take the top of the shoe and you unfold it into UV space. So basically, UVs have three coordinates, which you basically only use two. So like U, V, and then W, which is zero. And you can just basically, like if you use a vertex split, you can split the seams of a of an object based on the UVs, and then you can just say like the position should be equal to the vertex to the UV position, and you just get a actual unfolded geometry thing. So that's that thing. Then you make another weave pattern, which is that thing, and it ends up with like 5 million points, I think, because we're super close on it, so we need a lot of detail, which is what this thing was kind of heavy. And you're actually probably wondering, like, why didn't you just use the texture map for this thing? Because like when I started this, I thought the effect was gonna be like the thing like getting loose and like dissipating into the air and then going back, but they just wanted like a sort of a wave thing going into the shoe. So that's why we made actual geometry for this thing. Anyway, to continue, so I have this patch, and then you have that thing. Then you just extrude that thing, and then you volume sample. If you can do a volume sample. That's basically if you make a VDB from that extruded thing, then the inside of the volume is one, and the outside is zero. So you can just do a if statement like volume sample. Like if it's inside, then keep it. If it's outside the volume, remove it. And that was the fastest way to just remove all of the excess stuff. So that's what I did, and just fold it back to the original geometry, and then you get like all of the threads going on. And then the actual animation itself, which I forgot to record a video for that part, but it's just an attribute transfer again, and offsetting the position and then adding some noise, so it goes like so it's kind of simple effect, but it's it works pretty well. Alright, last but not least, the soul disintegration part. Oh Jesus, what am I doing? All right, another video. There we go. Decimation. All right, so we have this soul, and this was the part that changed the most, to be honest. Like I had, like there were like 5 versions of the soul thing. It was kind of annoying. It just blast away all the crap that you don't need. And And again, from the beginning on out, setting the vertex colors for this thing, so you could split those up in Maya to, like, do your shading and stuff. And then I'm going down the thing, distorting the actual geometry, and then I'm transferring attribute. I'm not sure why I did it like this, to be honest, in this case, instead of using the transfer in the attribute flop, but I did it like this. Then you just get this stop disappearing again, and you blast away all the crap. I think let's go through the hurry. Oh yeah, and another wave kind of a thing, so just offset the position based on the attribute and add some noise and make it look fancy, and then you extrude and then you extrude the thing downwards, so you just have some thickness, and then scatter a whole bunch of points in the thing which get the same color again because we did it from the beginning, and then have a ramp on it, and it's transferring the attribute again, and then with the ramp we can control the amount of points and can remove them based on the attribute, so we just get this outline of the points moving across the surface thing. There we go, so just moving across the surface thing, and then we're going into a very simple pop simulation, which is just only pops moving upwards and some noise being applied, so just very simple stuff. So that's the simulation stuff, and then if you want to get that into Maya, I don't have a video of that, but like loading points into Maya is horrible, and I don't know why they, like the Alembic loader in Maya is absolute crap. So you have to use Houdini engine to like load those points. So you just make a digital asset. You call it BGO loader. You load that digital asset into Maya, and you load your BGO sequence that you saved out with your pop simulation. You load it into Maya. Then you get your points into Maya, because apparently Maya cannot do that with Alembic. Don't ask. Like every software can do it, but except for Maya. Then you can bake those points towards an particle cache in Maya, and then Maya can use it to instance stuff. So then you can like I just made really tiny like blocks and stuff which would be instanced onto this in Maya, and then you get the particles moving upwards. So that was that effect. Now let's watch the video again, and of course then now you know how everything is made, and then we have some time for some questions. Let's first watch the video again. Without sounds and yeah. Oh, and there was one more effect which I didn't talk about. It's the airflow here, but it's basically just a very, very simple pyro sim. So I didn't thought it was useful to include it. That was just a displacement map thing on the surface. So yeah, and like all of the other cool stuff, the models and the shaders, that was all done by the guys from Colorbleed themselves. So they did an amazing job on that. Alright, so no questions, fragen, preguntas, whatever. Anybody has any question? Yeah, you. Yeah. I think they use like just like a V-Ray hair object. Yeah, because everything was rendered in V-Ray. So, more questions? Yeah.
Didn't you think 3 weeks is extremely short? Would it have been better?
The thing is, the client itself was pretty easy, so they didn't have a lot of feedback. Like they had a couple of things where they wanted it to be a little bit different, so that kind of helped. So it wasn't super stressful, to be honest. Like they were kind of easy going on that. So I made an initial planning for like how much time do I have for each effect, and kind of matched up, to be honest. So it wasn't really that stressful, like, and I mostly finished on time every day for finishing the thing. So it was pretty doable. Like ideally you would have liked more time to like try more variations for every effect, because normally you would like go through every effect and like make a couple of different things, and then like look what works best, what doesn't, and iterate on that. For this, it was basically, okay, I'm making this doesn't work, make another, yeah, that's good enough, okay, let's present it to the client likes it, okay, let's go. So that was, for me, it was doable. Obviously, I didn't do the modeling and the shading, so they started on the model before I worked, so when I started on it, they already had a model. As I said, the model changed a lot of times, but there was at least something to work on. So the effects and the shading were basically done over those three weeks.
And if you started from effects you had already done more or less before, completely?
Yeah, well, as I said, the setups that I showed aren't super complex or anything, and they like the thing that the client liked, the thing that we did like the year earlier that year, there was the Spin Awards, which is kind of some similar thing, like going into microscopic fibers and stuff. So a lot of the problems like the wires, how to render them in Maya, and some all of those issues already knew how that would work, so that that wasn't really a problem. It was just mostly getting something that looked kind of cool in short period of time. So yeah, more questions? Yeah.
So there's an option to just render in
Montreal. Well, like the thing is, Colorbleed has a Maya and V-Ray pipeline. I wasn't doing any of the shading, and they only recently started using Houdini over there. Like the when I did the Spin Awards there, that was the first project where they also used Houdini. So none of the shader guys there know any Houdini. So you have to go kind of like, you have to adapt to the pipeline that they're using. I mean, like, yeah, you cannot say to the shader guy like, okay, you just go into Houdini and learn Mantra in those 3 weeks and make that work. They have a whole pipeline working there with like checks for errors and stuff, and that all works great for the most part. So yeah, but probably like if I were to shade something myself, I would probably like do it in Houdini straight, and I'm probably in Redshift myself. But yeah, so wasn't an option for this in this case.